Woody Allen's comedy drama Bullets Over Broadway is in 50 minutes on BBC Two. But first, Mark Cousins meets the man behind the neuroses, the hypochondria, the angst, the paranoia, the anxiety.
There's something magical when a film goes through a projector, the beam of light.
It's in.
That's what Psycho was based on.
This is a shot from Hitchcock.
The camera always sees the truth.
Fantastic. We're going to watch films from throughout your career.
Woody Allen's probably the most famous film director in the world, so much so that the recent animated film Ants played on what everybody thinks they know about him.
I was not cut out to be a worker, I'll tell you right now. I feel physically inadequate. My whole life, I've never been able to lift more than 10 times my own body weight.
His neurosis, hypochondria, Jewishness, sexual obsession, and existential questioning.
I'm what you would call a teleological existential atheist.
The man himself was born Alan Stuart Koenigsberg in Brooklyn in 1935 to an Orthodox Jewish family full of women whose values, he said, were God and carpeting. At 16, he was writing 50 jokes a day. Influenced by Bob Hope, he started in stand-up comedy and then began a career in film writing and directing, which over three decades has amounted to 30 pictures, ranging from slapstick comedy to psychological drama.
Do you have a light in my glasses? It happens to me all the time.
But 6 years ago, people stopped laughing at Woody Allen. A sexual relationship with the then 21-year-old adoptive daughter of his partner, Mia Farrow, was reported worldwide. Another daughter, Dylan, apparently accused him of sexually abusing her. The ensuing court case was undignified, found the director to be an inadequate parent, but failed to support the child abuse charge. A panel of social workers concurred. Like the scandals in the lives of other artists, these events distracted people from the work itself. By that stage, Allen had received no less than 21 Oscar nominations.
People always say, oh, I very much liked your film, I very much liked your film. Because what can they say out of common politeness?
His total creative freedom over his films, the only other American to have this is Steven Spielberg.
If I had dinner at your home, even if I didn't like the meal, I would say to you, thank you very much, you know, it was wonderful.
No, you could be more honest than
you know.
Actors as varied as Julia Roberts, Michael Caine, Leonardo DiCaprio, Liam Neeson and Sean Penn have taken massive cuts in salary to work with him. And yet audiences for his work are not growing. So how do we account for the film world's cult of Woody Allen? How does he write, shoot and cut his pictures? Is it true, as one critic has said, that without Annie Hall, there'd be no Ally McBeal? Without Zelig, there'd be no Forrest Gump? Or is it more the case, as another put it about his constantly repeated obsessions, that Woody Allen needs to get out more? Here he is to talk about his life and work. Allen, you don't watch your films after they're released, and I've got clips here to show you of your films. What do you feel about the prospect of seeing them?
I feel that I'll look away if it's all the same to you, because my whole psychological approach since I started in film was to be ostrich-like. I make a film, I work on it for months and months and months, I see it, I edit it. When it's finished, I don't read the reviews of it, I don't speak to my friends about it, I don't follow the grosses of it, I don't look at it ever again. I made my first film in 1968, Take the Money and Run. I have not seen a frame of it since 1968.
Thank you.
wasted a moment of my life obsessing over the fact that I screwed up, or I made a terrible film, or I shot a bad scene, or how great I am, or how brilliantly I've done something.
How then do you learn about your mistakes? Surely Cézanne would look and say, I painted that painting of Mont Saint-Victoire badly. Here's how I can do it better, if you don't look at your work.
Well, I look at it 1,000 times while I'm making it. So, you know, it's not that I haven't seen the film. I've put it together frame by frame. I've shot it. I wrote it. I edited the film. And I know when it's over, I must remember never to make this mistake again. And then I make it again, because in an art form, every time out of the box, it's different. You're flying by the seat of your pants all the time. It's instinct. And if you're fortunate enough, you're right more often than you're wrong. And it's the best you can do.
He didn't show any other talent. He showed a lot of talent in his sports. But he did say to me years ago that if he had to choose a career, he would choose music. Anyhow, that's that.
Well, you did a good job, though.
Yeah.
One thing that strikes me is that your parents are still alive.
Yes.
Yes, and of course. And it sounds as if you haven't had any major bereavements in your life, and yet right from the beginning of your filmmaking career, you seemed to be particularly aware of your mortality, of the fact that people shuffle off.
I know.
Why, if death didn't hit you in the face, why have you been so concerned about it?
It's an amazing thing to me. My mother said to me when I was a little boy, for the first 5 years of my life, I was very sweet and up and happy. And then inexplicably at about 5 or so, I turned sour. She didn't know why. Nothing happened to my family. My parents didn't get divorced. My father just turned 99. My mother's 94. I don't know. I never had any problems. But I had an early awareness of mortality, an early terror of it. And it became an obsessive thing with me and has haunted me my whole life.
I was walking through the woods thinking about Christ. If he was a carpenter, I wondered what he charged for bookshelves. Suddenly...
Who are you?
Death.
What happens after we die? Is there a hell? Is there a God? Do we live again? All right, let me ask one key question. Are there girls?
You're an interesting young man. We'll meet again.
I'm 12 years old. I run into a synagogue. I ask the rabbi the meaning of life. He tells me the meaning of life. But he tells it to me in Hebrew. I don't understand Hebrew. Then he wants to charge me $600 for Hebrew lessons.
Look, you're getting on in years, right? Aren't you afraid of dying?
Why should I be afraid?
Because you won't exist.
So?
That thought doesn't terrify you?
Who thinks about such nonsense? Now I'm alive. When I'm dead, I'll be dead.
I don't understand. Aren't you frightened?
Of what? I'll be unconscious.
I know, but never to exist again?
How do you know?
But it certainly doesn't look promising.
Who knows what'll be? I'll either be unconscious or I won't. If not, I'll deal with it then. I'm not going to worry now about what's going to be when I'm unconscious.
Mom, come out.
Of course there's a God, you idiot. Don't believe in God.
But there's a God, then why is there so much evil in the world? Well, just on a simplistic level, why were there Nazis?
Tell him, Max.
How the hell do I know why there were Nazis? I don't know how the can opener works.
My contention would be that everybody has the same fear, and everybody's life revolves completely around dealing with that fear, the mitigating of the terror, and the rationalizing of it, you know, and that you can see the part religion plays in the world, and you can see the part family plays and procreation, and all of this is a response against this overwhelmingly terrifying thing. But maybe I'm wrong. Maybe it's just some, you know, weird little quirk that occurred in my life that I'm repressing in some way, and then I've pinned it all on this kind of grandiose, you know, sense of mortality, this huge phenomenon, this universal phenomenon, and it's really that I wasn't breastfed, probably, or some stupid little thing that I've translated into more socially acceptable problem.
Yeah, I'm sure this has been a subject that's come up between you and your analyst.
It has in the course of my lifetime. It's come up with everyone that I've spoken to, and it's come up in my films many times.
Yeah, of course. And there are real parallels between your life and your films. How do you think your work has been affected by this custody case and everything you had? Most people who went through a kind of turmoil of a private life, I think, would become either bitterer, more bitter, or more pessimistic. Your workload, you've made more films than ever since that period in the early 90s, and there's almost a lighter tone in your work. I don't know if that's true.
Yeah, because there's no correlation between the two. A lot of times the press likes to think that the two, you know, they look for meaning in my films and my private life, but there's no correlation. One thing is one thing, one thing's another. The fact that people have private lives that are either running smoothly or running turbulently or conflictingly, to me, has no bearing on my work.
Is that really true? Monet was affected by his increasing blindness. Dostoevsky was
increasing blindness. I mean, it's possible if I was, you know, losing my sight or my hearing or if I had cancer or something, this would affect me. But things in your private life, I mean, things in your love life and your private life, you know, are, to me, first of all, in the giant scheme of things, trivial problems. I mean, they're problems, but they're not, you're mentioning problems of, which to me are the real serious problems of life, the problems of mortality, of health, of failing, physical failing, and it's possible, God forbid, when something terrible ever happens to me, I would not be able to work so well and would not respond so well to it, and would not, and it would color my outlook. But domestic conflict and things like that, you know, that
I don't think many people would manage that separation that you seem to have there. I think it's a question for lots of creative people about mood and feelings of optimism. Is life a rapturous thing, or is it a valley of tears?
Well, I've always thought it was a valley of tears myself. I always thought it was. And no single phenomenon that isn't mortal would change that. That is to say, you know, the death of a loved one or something, I can see as, you know, knocking you for a loop and having an effect on you. But if I'm sad in my real life, it doesn't mean I make a sad film, or if I'm happy in my real life. You know, I mean, if anything, and I think Billy Wilder made this point in his interview, the opposite may be true. It's possible if you're sad in your life, you may make lighter films because you don't want to spend so much time in a dark, brooding, masochistic fashion.
Films are full of references to artists and mentors. Who are your particular idols?
There are so many people. I just turned 64 years old, and I still have so many idols, like an adolescent, like the adolescent who puts up pictures in his or her bedroom, pins up pictures of sports heroes and movie stars and artists. And
you're too old for that kind of thing.
Yeah, I am too old chronologically, and yet emotionally I have so many heroes, so many film directors, so many athletes, so many performers, comedians that I idolize and think are so wonderful and are so inspiring to me the work of Ingmar Bergman and Fellini and Kurosawa and Renoir and Truffaut and Godard and Chaplin and Keaton and the Marx Brothers and W.C. Fields and Ernst Lubitsch and Orson Welles and many athletes, you know, I mean, that I truly am awestruck by to this day.
And Hero worships the theme of your new film. Sean Penn plays a jazz guitarist who faints when he meets the greatest of all jazz guitarists, Django Reinhardt. The film's called Sweet and Lowdown. His work is sweet, but he's a low-down dirty dog. Now, is that the way creative people are? Is that the way you are?
Not all of them, by any means. But what's interesting to me are those artists who create these great works of beauty, whether it's music or painting or poetry, and you would think that the person who did this has got to be sensitive and compassionate and full of depth. And you meet the person and they're shallow and infantile and vain and cruel and untrustworthy, and so that to me is, you know, dramatic and comic and worth fooling around with in film. And I've done it in a number of films, actually. This is not the first one. If you recall Bullets Over Broadway, for example, the talented one is the murderer.
Let's say she was ruining the play. Well, she was not. She was just diminishing
it. She was ruining it.
Let's say she was ruining the play. Does that mean that she deserves to die?
There was nowhere to fire her.
What kind of inhuman monster are you?
I think you better leave.
I don't think I will. I think I better stay.
You should be thanking me. We're both in this together.
No, we're not. Because I didn't want her dead, see? You understand what I'm saying? I'm not in it at all. I'm not in anything.
You choose her over the show?
Of course. Of course I do, yes.
You think it's right some tootsie walks in and messes up a beautiful thing like this, huh?
I wanted a great play as much as you did.
No, not as much.
But you don't kill for it.
Yeah, who says? My father used to listen to the opera. He loved the opera. But if a guy stunk?
What, he killed him?
One time in Palermo.
I'm an artist too. I'm not a great artist like you, but I'm an artist. But you know what? First, I'm a human being. I'm a decent, moral human being.
There are many artists who are very lovely people, but they're just not as interesting for me to write about as the ones who are so antithetical in their personal lives.
I've got here a clip from Sweet and Lowdown where Samantha Morton and Sean Penn have just had sex, and he plays the song Everybody's Blowing Bubbles to her.
Right. I'm for Blowing Bubbles.
I'm for Everybody's Blowing Bubbles. Here's the scene, which you're not looking at.
I'm not, but I know it so well. You know, I've just worked with it for...
What did you want to do in this scene? What's it about this scene?
I wanted to have Sean play the guitar and show the effect that his music, what a boor he's been, that he's taken this poor girl home and slept with her and just wants her out. He couldn't care less about her, and he promised that he would play for her. But when he plays music, it's so full of feeling and so haunting that you can see the effect it has on Samantha, that it's so touching to her, it's so moving to her. And of course she did not let me down. She made the right faces at the right time.
She's making a face. You could sneak a little like that.
I know what it is.
You know exactly
me.
What that face is.
I know what that face is. I sat through it many times.
And she doesn't speak at all in the film.
Right.
Why?
Why? Because when I wrote the story, I thought the character that Sean Penn plays is such a braggart and so self-involved and so vain and so full of himself that the ideal woman for him to fall in love with is one that just idolized him and couldn't speak at all. She just lives for him. She just worships him. And Samantha did not let me down. She played it exactly the way I wanted it.
It reminded me of City Lights, that Chaplin picture.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Of course, she's slender.
Yes, very, very beautiful relationship between Virginia Sherrill, the girl.
She's still alive?
That I don't know. Yeah.
mentioning Chaplin there, it made me think that people like Charlie Chaplin and Groucho Marx, they had their screen image, a very strong, sort of almost iconic screen image, but in real life they look somewhat different. Now, everybody knows that you have this strong screen image, but you, like, look rather similar in real life.
I do.
The same glasses and everything like that. Now, if you are concerned about people confusing your movies and your life, why do you not modify your what you look like in a movie so that people don't make that mistake?
It's too late. I should have thought of it when I first started. If I had thought that everyone was going to think there's not a big difference between me as there is between Charlie Chaplin, the man, and the tramp on the screen, I might have chosen some kind of broader character. But I don't know if I would have had the skill to do that. I mean, I think the only character I can play on the screen is a character that does not have to play too broadly, but because of that I am very often mistaken for the character in my movies, because I look like the character in my movies and I sound like the character in my movies when I'm not in my movies.
Maybe it's not a big too late. You could start now.
Put on a fake mustache.
And different glasses.
Something.
Yeah.
This is Mr. Fielding Mellish, one of our company's research testers, who will demonstrate the Execusizer. Now, would you notice every part of the body receives an adequate exercise and workout with this machine? The pedaling action developed the muscles to keep the leg muscles flexible.
When I first started making films, all I cared about was being funny. Joke, and if the audience laughed, I felt I did my job, and that was fine with me.
There's a handle for each arm, and as he pulls those handles, the back muscles are brought into action in a manner that keeps the back flexible and keeps the back strong. And notice the basketballs come inside of the machine, and the basketballs, as they're handled by Mr. Mellish, develop reflexes.
Have you any idea how many you can put out of here?
Well, we'd like you to manufacture them. We can let you have the idea. We can let you have our patents. We can let you have the whole thing on a royalty basis.
Oh, boy, I'd like to do that.
No question of time, you'll do business with the United States government.
I'm not suited to this job.
Then, after a few films, I started to think, you know, I could give them a richer experience, I think. In addition to the comedy, you know, there could be real characters and real story, but in order to do that, one has to sacrifice some laughs, and that sacrifice, I think, worked positively. I think audiences like those later films better, although there are some people that to this day will still say that they liked the few earlier films of mine the most. And, you know, I think my later films are better.
I do not want to spend Sunday together because I need some time alone.
So be alone. I'm certainly not pushing you.
Yes, you are. And that quiet, steady way of yours. You're always there for me. Supportive is your word. Understanding. God, stop being so bloody well understanding.
Thanks for
well,
me.
I'm sorry, right? I still think a lot about Sally. I still have feelings for her. Feelings I don't think I could ever have for you. Oh, God. Where are you going? Oh, shit. Judy.
I never want to see you again, okay?
Oh, don't say that, Judy. I need you. I need you.
It's good to know how you really
but
feel.
But I don't feel that way.
Know.
I was just upset, darling.
You
please.
Are so selfish and
I am,
self-centered.
I know.
Don't
give up on me. I didn't mean those things.
Why did you say them for
I said them because I'm confused. I'm upset. Lord, I never want to hurt you again in my life.
Bullshit.
It's not bullshit. I don't deserve you. I'm sorry. Please.
Now, these more mature films were all shot by the great Gordon Willis, and of course he was famous as the cinematographer on the Godfather pictures, amongst others.
I learned a lot from Gordon. He's, I think, the best American cinematographer we've had.
I don't want to make funny movies anymore. They can't force me to. I don't feel funny. I look around the world and all I see is human suffering.
Human suffering doesn't sell tickets in Kansas City.
They want laughs in Kansas City. They've been working in the wheat fields all day.
That's a very kind of photographed film.
Yes, that took us a long time to make. Everyone had to hit his mark or her mark precisely and to get that look, because the whole film really took place in the mind of the protagonist. And so I didn't want it to look like the real world.
And you and Willis seem to evolve a certain style of shooting.
Mm-hmm.
The actors would walk out of shot and there'd be an empty shot and they'd be talking off camera.
Right, I still do that. That's just one shot that we devised and we liked the look of it, so we did it a number of times.
Is decaying. Am I the only one that saw that? The universe is gradually breaking down. There's not going to be anything left. I'm not talking about my stupid little films here. Eventually, there's not going to be any Beethoven or Shakespeare or...
Have a nice weekend.
Oh, great.
Do
Do you remember the scene in Annie Hall where you and Diane Keaton have bought lobsters?
Yeah, sure. That was the first scene we shot in that movie. That was the first scene I ever shot with Gordon Willis, and it was the first scene that Keaton and I made in Annie Hall, the very first one.
It's a single take, and you like hit the light, but presumably by mistake. And
yes,
that's
yeah.
very kind of.
Yes, and we started laughing because she starts laughing, and of course, whenever she laughs, I laugh because she always had that ability to get to me, and that was the take that had the most spontaneity in it because we were legitimately laughing.
Come on, Albie, they're only baby ones, for God's sake.
If they're only babies, then you pick them up.
Oh, all right. Here.
Oh, don't give it to me. Don't. Here. Look, one crawl behind the refrigerator. It'll turn up in our bed at night. Will you get out of here with that thing? Jesus.
Get it.
Talk to him. You speak shellfish. Hey. Look, put it in the pot.
I can't put it in the pot. I can't put a live thing in hot water.
What do you think we're going to do? Oh, take it to the movies?
Here you go. Oh, good, Al. You'll say. Ah!
Okay, it's in.
All
right, it's definitely in the pot. Annie, there's a big lobster behind the refrigerator. I can't get it out. This thing's heavy. Maybe if I put a little dish of butter sauce here with a nutcracker, it'll run out the other side. You know what I mean?
I'm going to get my camera. Hold on.
You know,
is this the sort of scene that you would have scripted entirely?
I did script it, but with all my scenes, I walk all over the script and I encourage my actors to improvise. I'm not a jealous guardian of my own material. And so, you know, I'm able to get a certain spontaneity often when the actors respond to that.
It's funny to hear that because I read somewhere that you said in an interview, I wouldn't work with any actor that challenged my blocking. And of course, blocking is the arrangement of people on a set. Do you think that's true?
No. First of all, I can't imagine that I would have said that because I really let the actors walk all over me. That's one of the reasons they like to work with me, because I let them say what they want. I let them change what they want. Now, the blocking, you know, I'm a little more strict about than the writing, only because, you know, I work out the shot with the cameraman. I mean, I could see an instance where I might say, it's essential, it may not feel good to you, but it's essential for the shot you do this. But I'm very liberal with the actors. I mean, I never make them wear any costumes they don't like, or say lines they don't like, or, you know. And they feel a great deal of freedom.
How do you account for the fact that Sam Shepard said this extremely literate thing, which was Woody Allen is a piss-poor director of actors?
I don't know. I could never. In fact, I said, when I saw Sam, I said, I can't believe you said that. And he said, yes, I did say it. You know, I like Sam a lot. And, you know, we've seen each other since then. That was his experience with me.
Did you fire him or something like that?
No, I didn't fire him for a second. He worked on a film of mine. I shot the film over. I did such a poor job on the film that I shot it over.
September.
And he was not available, you know, to do it a second time, which I can understand. So I used a different actor in the role. But his experience with me, from his point of view, was that I was a poor director, you know, I can't necessarily argue with him. I mean, if that was his experience, I thought I was doing the right thing. You know, most of the people I've worked with over the years seem to be satisfied, or maybe they're not as outspoken as Sam. You know. But I don't know.
Apparently, Michael Caine phoned up Jenna Rollins when she was going to be in Another Woman and say, look, be careful, you won't get any close-ups. And
yeah, that was just a coincidence. I generally, you know, shoot the film according to the demands of the script. When I shot Hannah and Her Sisters, there were just no close-ups required in the Michael Caine scene. The scenes played better in wider shots, and I shot it that way.
Hi.
Well, what are you doing here?
Well, I'm looking for a bookstore.
In this section?
Yeah, I'm killing time. I have a client near here, and I'm quite early.
Oh.
How about you?
Well, I live...
Oh, yes. You live near
yes,
here?
Yes, I do.
Where are you headed?
Oh, I was just going to my AA meeting.
after a week of shooting, Michael came to me and said, I usually save my best work for my close-ups, but you're not shooting any close-ups. And I said, well, don't save it. Just, you know, just do it right out, because there probably won't be any. It never would have occurred to me the phenomenon of somebody saving the best work for the close-ups. I mean, that's an actor's trick that would have been unknown to me. So I didn't know. I just know that I always knew Michael Caine as a kind of flawless actor, that he's one of those actors where everything he says sounds real all the time. So I just thought, no matter what I do with Michael Caine, I'm going to get a great performance. And I did, as it turned out. I think he won an Academy Award for that role. And I mean, I'm not saying any thanks to me. He was great before he met me, and he was great after he left me. I'm glad he told me about the close-up thing. I mean, I looked out for it in future films, you know. I mean, it made me aware that possibly some actors think that there's going to be a close-up. Whereas when I shot Another Woman, because the nature of the material was different, there were many close-ups in the picture, because it was a much more serious, introspective picture.
I met a really sad woman today. A woman you'd think would have everything. But she doesn't. She has nothing. And it made me feel frightened. Because I feel if I don't stop myself, as the years go by, I'm gonna wind up that way. She can't allow herself to feel. So the result is she's led this cold, cerebral life and has alienated everyone around her.
Another Woman's one of your best, but what's the worst film you've made?
There's so many of them, I can't. It would be hard.
Give me the top three bad ones.
I've made many bad films. It would be hard for me to pick one, but let me say this. I don't think I've ever made one that really has lived up completely to my own expectations for it. There have been a couple that have come close. Purple Rose of Cairo was one, Bullets Over Broadway was one, Zelig was one, Husbands and Wives was one. But I mean, I'm talking like four films like out of 30. Most of them, I finish the film and I look at them and I say, this is the film and this is what I started with. And I see the difference. I'm disappointed so frequently. Now, the audience isn't always so disappointed because they don't know what I started with. The megalomaniacal dreams I had at the beginning, the grandiose visions.
What goes wrong in general? Billy Wilder, for example, says, you know, a film is never as funny as the script. Is that it?
For me,
does comedy
I would agree
get lost
completely.
In the shooting?
Yeah, because when you're sitting home at your desk or on your bed, wherever it is you write, it's beautiful. The whole process is appearing in your mind's eye. And so everything is smooth and the actors are ideal and everything is going great and it's funny. Then you finish it and you find you're not going to really get the actor you wanted for that part. And the location is not right. And the person you got is not doing it perfectly. And the joke you thought was so funny is not quite so funny. And you have a cold that day and you don't direct quite that well. And you can't afford to have 50 extras, you have to do that scene with 20 extras. And as my friend Marshall Brickman says, the truck with fresh compromises pulls up every day and unloads them. And this is what, and by the end of the film, you know, you've got an enormous compromise, sometimes less of a compromise, sometimes you come closer to your vision. But I would say Wilder was completely correct in that. It's so much easier, you know, or Tennessee Williams said, it's a shame you have to put on a play. It's a shame you can't write it and just throw it in the drawer, but you have to put it on. And with all the money in the world that people spend, they spend $100 million on a film, $50 million, and all the years of experience. You could get an experienced director, experienced actors and writers. They still make terrible films, or films that just miss, or films that are not very good. For all the effort that's put in, because it is really not easy to do.
Mentioning Billy Wilder again, I don't know if you saw recently, but he said this thing which is interesting. He said, Woody Allen makes great episodes.
Right, and it's just something that I like more. You know, Billy Wilder's talking from the point of view being a master of narrative structure. And I think I've done that in a couple of films where I've made a narrative film, but not much. I haven't concentrated on that. Maybe I should do that a couple of times because it would be stimulating for me and interesting. I know when I see his films, you know, I find them exhilarating. I think I can make that kind of film, but I generally like the episodic style better.
All right, Miss Kubelik, get up.
What's your favorite episode of any one of your films? Is that possible to say?
My favorite episode?
Favorite moment or scene?
Well, I wouldn't say that I had a favorite, but certain ones come to my personal mind. I mean, you know, in Radio Days, I thought it was a funny episode when the two crooks were robbing the house and they're interrupted by a phone call and it's a quiz show and they win all this merchandise for the people that they're stealing from.
What? The sailor's hornpipe.
Huh? The sailor's hornpipe?
The sailor's hornpipe? That's right! Mr. Marty Needleman, you've won the grand jackpot!
You know, I thought it was funny when Robin Williams went out of focus in Deconstructing Harry. I've had a lot of episodes in my films, and I like that style.
Grace, I'm home.
Hi, Ernie. Hey, what's the matter? You look strange.
I'm out of focus.
Yeah, you are. Just a little bit. You are, and you look pale.
Daddy, you're all blurry.
Yeah, maybe you should go lay
Daddy,
down. I'll bring you some
focus.
Tea and toast in bed.
Daddy doesn't need that, okay?
Yes, come on, now, you be nice.
What's not perhaps well known is that you reshoot a lot more. I think your actors know that they will be called back to do new scenes.
Right.
They won't, as far as I understand, be asked to redub the films, but
right,
they'll be called back. Now, why reshoot so much? September, you reshot entirely. Crimes and Misdemeanors, you reshot a third of it or something. Why?
Of course, I could never understand when I first made my first film, Take the Money and Run, how any filmmaker ever makes a film without reshooting it. It would be like an author pulling his novel out of the typewriter and publishing it, but they don't. When you're a writer, you take your novel out, and then you rewrite scenes, and you do the second draft, and you look at that, and you fix things. Otherwise, you'd be lost. And this goes for anybody. I mean, this can be Tolstoy or, you know, whoever you want to use as an example. The same thing with filmmakers. You finish a film, and you look at it, and then you say, oh my gosh, it sags in the third quarter, or this character is too vicious, he needs to be made a little more likable, or it's great, but the end doesn't work. And you've got to do your rewrites and your adjustments. I can't think of any other way to do it. And I can't imagine that any other director can. To me, it would be a stupendous achievement for a director to finish a film and say, well, that's it, no reshoots, I just did a brilliant job. And maybe some of them can do that, but I'm certainly not one that can.
But the other way to do it is the Billy Wilder way, which is to rewrite for a year, sort of almost kill yourself banging your head against the wall to get the structure right before you start shooting.
Well, I try. I do my best with the script to get it, and for all the correctness that I can achieve prior to doing it, there's still problems afterward. I think Billy Wilder would agree in his films, if he could go over some of them, there are still moments he could make move faster or moments he could make work better in some of them. I just can't imagine not doing it that way. I'm just not good enough.
But in the 1990s, you've made more than one film a year.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's a very prolific output. And it doesn't, I don't know your work methods, but it doesn't sound to me as if you would have a time to bang your head against the wall for long enough before you go into pre-production or production,
I
whatever
do.
It's called.
I do. I'm able to. I spend time, put in a lot of time thinking about the script, a lot of time thinking about it. I write the script, you know, as close as I can to the finished product, but I want to leave space in there for spontaneity. I want to leave room for the fact that when I cast, I suddenly find that a different actor is going to be even better than what I conceived, or the locations that I thought I was going to shoot the scene in a baseball stadium, and now I find that an opera house is available. It's very beautiful, and I want to. When I did Annie Hall, I never had my character living underneath that ride at Coney Island. But when we were looking in Coney Island, there was an apartment underneath that whatever you call it, that roller coaster. And I said, great, have him live under there.
My analyst says I exaggerate my childhood memories, but I swear I was brought up underneath the roller coaster in the Coney Island section of Brooklyn. Maybe that accounts for my personality, which is a little nervous, I think.
I don't like to have everything finished in advance, but, you know, there's no way to get a sure thing.
I have some trouble between fantasy and reality.
We talked earlier about whether people can detach themselves from the drama of their own lives, and you made a film about that, Crimes and Misdemeanors. What's its story?
Marty Landau is being plagued by this woman, Angelica Houston, and he doesn't want his life upset.
I can't go on like this. I can't wait forever.
Listen to me. Maybe
you don't know what it's like.
Maybe it would help if you talked to somebody. I mean, like a therapist or somebody, you know?
Don't trick me, Judah. Christ, I'm shaking.
I wanted to show that, cruel as it is, there is nobody out there that's going to punish you if you don't have a conscience yourself. If you're willing to commit a criminal act, or willing to murder in his case, and it doesn't bother you, and you can get away with it, fine. And he's, in the end, even though he's repulsed by the idea at first, even when his brother first brings it up, he's starting to think, you know, I guess he's right. This is really the only way I'm going to be able to do this, and the only thing standing between you and immorality is your own conscience.
Let me just get something straight here. Am I understanding you right? I mean, are you suggesting getting rid of her?
You won't be involved, but I'll need some cash.
It's a human life. You don't think God sees?
God is a luxury I can't afford.
Now you're talking like your brother Jack.
Jack lives in the real world. You live in the kingdom of heaven. I managed to keep free of that real world, but suddenly it's found me.
Marty Landau is going to rationalize somehow that he's going to do this. He's going to do whatever is necessary to get out of this situation.
I will not be destroyed by this neurotic woman.
And Sam Waterston, the rabbi, says something like, you know, I don't know how you can go on if you don't have a moral structure. And God sees, and of course, there's a lot of blindness in this film. But it's like if somebody doesn't have a moral structure, if they can do whatever they want, then they're too free, surely. Isn't that the problem? He's just too free if he doesn't care whether he kills his
mistress.
That's
right, and if you can get away with it, you know, it's done all the time. And the only thing that that you have to go by is your own moral compass.
Is what she's doing to me just? Is this what I deserve? Jack, it's Judah. I think we should move ahead with what we discussed.
I mean, we beat the Nazis in the war, as was pointed out in the movie, but if we hadn't, if things had gone different, and there were a number of ways they could have gone differently, and the Nazis had won the war, or America had not entered the war, and they had taken over all of Europe, you know, they would have slept very well nights doing those things that they did, because they didn't have a negative conscience about it.
So, do you have a strong moral compass? If so, where did you learn it? Was it from family or books?
I don't think I have any special one. I mean, you know, I have a normal thing. I mean, I try and do the right thing. I wouldn't classify myself among the evil of the world or among the righteous particularly. I'm kind of middle, you know, middle class person trying to do what I think is right, doing it sometimes, failing at it sometimes, misreading it sometimes, you know, but my impulses generally are decent. I mean, I don't think I've been guilty of deliberate cruelty. I'm not saying I haven't been cruel to people in my life. I may have been, but never deliberately. I don't think any of my films is a big deal. I mean, I think I'm given more credit than I deserve on them, that I am really a comic television comedy writer and comic turned filmmaker, in no way intellectual.
I'll say it once again. The eyes of God see all.
I have no ideas. I want to entertain.
You can't say in no way intellectual. Surely you're underplaying your ambitions. And when you think of the people who influenced you, like the Marx Brothers or like Bob Hope, for example, there's a world away from them and a film like Crimes and Misdemeanors.
Yes, but there is no, you know, real rhyme or reason to any of it, or no guiding philosophical thing. If the next film I think of is a musical or is a film about, you know, plague in 12th century Denmark, you know, that's what I'll do. You know, it's just whatever idea that I happen to get at the time that I think I want to share with an audience and that they'll enjoy.
Woody Allen, thank you very much.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you. You may recognize this gentleman.
I do recognize that gentleman.
Django Reinhardt, a bit of rare archive there of him. Stefan Grappelli as well. Right then, Woody. I'm really surprised you didn't watch any of your own scenes. Quite impressive, I think.
It is probably a defense mechanism. I mean, there's a lot of psychological problems you have making film.
Well, he may not want to watch it, but you can. Bullets Over Broadway is next on BBC Two. And next week,